It's okay. Yes. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. A very good morning to everyone here. I am so pleased to see the hall almost full, and the women are showing their muscles. Honored guests, speakers and role players, fellow IAP members, three brave men who chose to be with the women, my wonderful participants, ladies and gentlemen, and of course, members of the media, make sure that you show and take pictures of this wonderful women crowd here. And put in the front page of tomorrow's paper. Ladies and gentlemen, honored guests again, delegates, welcome to JB, Johor Bahru, and to the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum, WBN as well. For the WBN, it is the 7th forum. I am pleased to see some very familiar faces who have consistently been supporting us from the first forum that we've had. And some of you are newcomers. You are the first timers here, and I bid you a very warm welcome. Ladies and gentlemen, most of our guests, foreign visitors, would know KL and Singapore, but they would not know what is in between, that is JB. Even though actually it is just a swim away from Singapore. And now they see to their wonder how wonderful JB is, and especially the new Iskandar development that will give us women a lot of opportunities in terms of business and also to garner your entrepreneurship. What we have today is following the very famous slogan of WIEF, that is building bridges towards through business. We are here as women, we are women, not as women, we are women. We are not just building bridges, we are also creating a serious bonding from among us. And bonding is very important when you are living in a very hostile world. Ladies and gentlemen, WIEF WBN, World Business Network, was established 8 years ago precisely to promote, expand, and strengthen the participation of women in business, born out of the conviction that business and entrepreneurship provide the gateway and path to self-sufficiency and economic independence for women. Of course, the indirect and true contribution is to the economic development and growth of our nations and also the world. Today, WBN celebrates our 7th birthday. Not tall and mighty yet, but we are getting there. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to refer, if most of you are living in the hotels, to refer to page 14 of the New Straits Times. Case for more working women. In this article, it tells everything about women and the need to narrow the gap, the gender gap. Now, if you were to read all of this, actually, I can terminate my speech for this morning. However, I would like to still have my say. Now, even though it talks about Malaysia specifically, of how there is a serious need to, to narrow the gender gap, Shaikha, you are in the business of providing water and food. Could I have some water on this here, please? Okay. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to highlight to you, for those who know very little about WBN, but we are getting almost famous there. Because why? Today in this room, the registered members or delegates coming for the Women Forum was 220 as of 3rd December. And today, there's 350. I would like to think it is because of me, but no. It is because of the need for bonding and to network to actually meet the fantastic women in this hall who are successful icons in their own right. Before I brag about what WBN has done, I would like to pose to you a riddle. A man and his son went cycling one evening. As they were negotiating a band, they were hit by a van. The man died. The son survived and was rushed to the hospital for surgery. In the operations room, the surgeon said, "I can't operate on him. He is my son." "Who is the surgeon?" Tongues began to wag. "Oh, the mother must have had an affair. And this is the real father, the surgeon. Oh, he was sent for adoption." What is it? Ladies, it is never so obvious, even to you right now, that that surgeon is the boy's mother. Do you see it? We always say surgeon. We never say it's a man or a woman. But the perception is always that surgeon is a man. Now, this is the psychological, social psychological imprint that still persists, even though in this time and era, engineers, solar providers, solar energy providers, aerospace experts, physicists are no longer rarities. I mean, these women are no longer a rare breed. So is a male nurse on the other side of the divide. So what is needed is for us to change and not stereotype anymore. But, ladies and gentlemen, it goes to show that gender stereotyping is still alive and kicking. It is no doubt still difficult for women to stand counted and have their a bigger footprint on this earth. It is almost a cliche to say that women still face enormous challenges. Despite these, and in spite of the rough and tough road traveled by women, we have progress. Seize opportunities, whatever opportunities that were made available, and translate them to success. The glass ceilings are cracking somewhat in the corporate and management positions, as you will see amongst you are CEOs of big companies and corporations. But they are still there. Now, we can either choose to think that our position is like the glass that is half full or half empty. I like to take the position that the glass is half full, but I would whisper into your ears, they are actually two-thirds empty. The future actually glimmers ahead for us women. We can fill that glass to the brim if opportunities are made available to us. And we can do it. I start by saying that women can do what they want, attain whatever they achieve and dream, but we must start with, well, I have to say to you in French, a quotation in French, "Il faut toujours se sentir bien dans sa peau." Have you got the translation right? Or nobody is having the earphone? It sounds like Jawa, ya, Pak Tanri. It means one must feel good under your own skin, whatever color. And this is the first way to progress. To have confidence is to have information, to be well-informed and to have knowledge. This is only too well known that we can achieve this because of the following developments that are happening around the world that is constantly evolving. First, nations have already recognized that women are economic assets, precious human capital, not sufficiently exploited in the positive way. education has become our great enablers to be where we were not there before. Generally, the world has evolved, values have changed, and women are no longer shackled to the kitchen. If they do, it is by choice, because cooking is a profession right now. It has become clear that women business styles are no longer viewed as soft, but valuable at the workplace. With the Wall Street shaken, especially with the demise of Lehman Brothers, cautious risk-taking nature of women are viewed as natural safeguards to overbearing and risky dealings. We see before us the world that now value us, circumstances and development that need us, situation that favor us. We can't possibly fail. But everything begins with the conviction that anything is possible. Women need to take full responsibility over their lives and thrive on the gift of choice that are before us. We have with us here today amazing women who made choices to seize opportunities, thrive, persevere, and succeed. I was overwhelmed by this special lady that I met in Singapore during the Forbes Power Women Forum. She wears a huge crown, hot, huge crown of success, by pushing an innovative idea on solar farming. This lady from Thailand, who very naively thought that IFC of the World Bank is in Hong Kong. So she went to Hong Kong after going to the spa 5 times to make her skin look good, because she thought to be successful, you must be beautiful, without realizing that she is already very beautiful. Not shaken by that mistake, she make a U-turn, or I don't know, a straight direct flight to Washington, to the World Bank. There, she convinced the World Bank, the IFC, to do the project together with us. So she not only won their hearts, she won their money. And now, she has a company that is listed on the stock exchange of Thailand, producing 241,607 megawatts of solar energy. Hot. I mean, her very presence here, I think, have warmed up this room. There is yet another lady who is an iconic businesswoman. She is in everything. She took over her father's business and enlarged it and diversified it into everything under the sun. Oil and gas, mining, property development, food and beverages. And I just learned from her last night that the best milk is donkey's milk. And we do have a lot of donkeys around. Donkeys with black hair, you know. I'm joking. She's also into trading and everything you can think of. But does success give her a swollen head? No. Is she drowned in arrogance? No. She is humbled by her success. She is giving back to society. She is now better known as a philanthropist than her business iconic position. This, ladies and gentlemen, is something that we must remind ourselves constantly, that in achieving success, we must also seek barakah. We all know the meaning of barakah. We have brought to you in this hall, and I'm so proud, women who have broken the glass ceilings. Even the pre-stressed concrete, they have broken. And they are now leading businesses in highway, never heard of before, managed by women. Airlines, now everyone can fly. You can guess who that woman is. And we have a woman running a biotech company that is acclaimed by Stanford, by Harvard Medical School, etc., etc. But these women do not shout out their glories. They are humble in their success. And this woman who is in biotech, that is revered by Harvard School, for example, runs a soup kitchen 4 times nightly, untiringly. I mean, you know, you ask me to go out once a night, I'll be so tired. Actually, I'm not, okay. Now, let me briefly tell you what we at WBN try to do for women. As part of the WI Foundation, young in age with very, very modest wallet, WBN is nonetheless very ambitious. We plan and retain is our objective to play an effective role in promoting and developing economic self-sufficiency on women. We have 2 kinds of workshops. One is special training programs to enlighten women on how to be a true businesswoman, to be careful with financial management, to have market strategies, to do a proper business plan, to make sure that branding and packaging becomes a part of your plan yearly. These workshops are held twice yearly and have proven to be successful and extremely popular. I had earlier said that technology is women's best friend these days, and indeed they are. A new WBN product introduced earlier this year, the Web Rich Internet Marketing Workshop, brought the world market to the doorstep of the women, especially those who are in micro-business and SMEs. We have run 2 web-rich internet marketing workshops, one in Kuala Lumpur and more recently in Nairobi, attended by 31 ladies from Tanzania, Uganda, and Kenya. The internet, Facebook, and Twitter offer women the unthinkable, bringing the world to their doorstep. And through the internet marketing, the world has become the market for their products. These ladies were taught how to create websites and web pages to introduce, advertise, and sell their products. No big deal, you might say. But big deals were being clinched after their websites were posted. No big deal, but big deals, business deals were made. I only have 1 minute, impossible. Now, I have to tell this because this is something that will motivate other women. One lady from the first web-rich internet marketing, on the 4th day of the workshop, posted her website and received orders that she could not cope with. Imagine that, even before they received the certificates. 2 ladies from the Nairobi workshop are millionaires in the making. One who called her project, her business, as Auto Village, is no more a village. It is being flooded by cars that needed to be repaired and maintained, and they chose her garage. And now she is opening a bigger garage. Another lady is now certainly going to be a millionaire. Her project, her website, her product on debt recovery has now been accepted by many, many banks in Nairobi. Debt recovery. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the world of business. Welcome to the world of success and economic independence. Okay, I have to skip a lot of things. But once I'm on the stage, nobody can control me, okay? We have always talked about success based on profitability, on wealth, on money. But there is more and more talk about social entrepreneurship now. Social entrepreneurship is about giving dignity to the less, to the needy, to the less endowed, to the vulnerable. And famous among these social entrepreneurs is Professor Yunus, you know him, the founder of Grameen Bank, who has made life easier for women, the many women in Bangladesh who are not as endowed as us, who doesn't even know what Birkin bag is, who doesn't know what Chanel is, but is day-to-day living. And now they are independent, self-sufficient. And these are the kind of people that we should also promote. Here, within our milieu here, is someone who involves herself passionately in social entrepreneurship. It's none other than Her Royal Highness, the Sultana of Johor, Raja Zara Sophia, who will be with us this afternoon. Don't leave your seat. To share her experience, thoughts, passion and satisfaction in helping others, giving meaning to their otherwise unfortunate life. For these people, including those who are successful in business in the corporate world and those who are now pursuing social entrepreneurship as their passion, we applaud them. They inspire us, and we must really, really be truly inspired by them. So I beseech you to interact, to connect with them, to network with them, so that you become truly inspired. And what is most important, I would like to see some collaborative agreements be made between you, you know, less successful, more successful, going to be successful, let's interact, let's network, and let this world be a better place with women participating in business and entrepreneurship. Before I end, I want to tell you about the story of hairline. You realize that we always comb our hair in a certain direction, and suddenly we see that that part that is always exposed is balding. So we try to shift that hairline to the other side so that we can cover the balding piece. I do that. But it is so difficult to shift it to the other side. However, we keep doing it. We put hair pin. First day, second day, third day. Finally, the hair will move to the other side and our balding head is covered. By the same notion, we women persevere. This is a simple example of a hairline, but that is an example of life, of living, how we can make things change according to our needs. However, do not try to change that is unchangeable. So, my parting remarks is these words from Dennis Whitley. Very inspiring. Ladies and gentlemen, the courageous one, the courageous thorns among the wonderful roses here, I salute you. Ladies and gentlemen as well, change the changeable. Accept the unchangeable. And please remove yourself from the unacceptable. That is the way to live a happy, wonderful life. Thank you so much. And I hope the deliberations will go positively the way that we all intended to do. And I know women will not let us down. The sisterhood of women is the most wonderful, fundamental parameter that we must find ourselves in, the sisterhood of women. Women who are successful must reach out to the other women and bring them up to the success that you are also enjoying. So, strengthen the sisterhood of women. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam, and a big round of applause again, once again, ladies and gentlemen, to Yang Berhormat Datuk Dr. Noraisa Muhammad, the chairman of the WEF Business Women Network, for the very encouraging and inspirational remarks to set the tone for today's forum going. And yes, we are indeed privileged to be here today to hear and learn from a number of other key and successful women. And to set the ball rolling, we're going to have the first session, which is the CEO panel, Women Entrepreneurs, Catalysts for Change. And we're privileged once again to be able to welcome our speakers. Madam Wandee Khunchornyakong, Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of SPCG Public Company Limited, Kingdom of Thailand. Also, Dr. Shaikha Al Maskari, Chairperson of Al Maskari Holdings, Tricon Group, and Johnson Controls and Global Communications from United Arab Emirates. And to chair or moderate this session, we have Dato Hazimah Zainuddin, a successful person in her own right, founder and managing director of Hyrax Oil, Sdn. Berhad, Malaysia. With that, I'd like to invite the speakers and the moderator to come up on stage to take their positions. And with that, I'll hand over the session to Yang Berhad Dato Hazimah Zainuddin to moderate this session. Silakan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Distinguished guests, panel participants of the 8th World Islamic Economic Forum, WIEF. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good morning to all. How are you all this morning? After being inspired by Datuk Dr. Nur Aisyah, I think all of us are like full of energy to listen to the both of the speakers here. Yeah? So Datuk Nur Aisyah always inspire me in her ways. She always speak out her mind out, and she's really an amazing person. Anyway, welcome to the CEO panel forum with a very, very important, interesting topic, yeah? Which is the Women Entrepreneurs Catalyst for Change. I'm very honored to be the moderator for this session this morning, and we have two very, very distinguished and special speakers who will share their experiences in running their business, which are done in a non-conventional way for women, as they say, women running a business in the men's world, and industry is dominated by men. Am I right? Yeah. So we always get this kind of question: why are you running business that is run by men? I wonder sometimes whether men, they are asked this question: why are you running a business that runs by women? Because the famous chef, the famous shoemaker in the world are all men, which is they are doing women's shoes and cooking women kind of stuff. So anyway, but those are just questions asked by people: why are we running business in the men's world? But anyway, in Malaysia, I'm proud. I think what Dato' Nur Aisyah mentioned just now, we are proud to see women entrepreneurs in various industries, ranging from oil and gas, aerospace, biotech, manufacturing, retailing, trading, and so many other businesses that they're doing. And we're lucky that the government is looking at us quite seriously and acknowledge the fact that the women entrepreneurs contribute to the economic development of the nation. We, as women entrepreneurs, we always discuss about related issues on women entrepreneurship. Why are we not talking about something which is the women are not being taken care of, looked at seriously? But in Malaysia, we discuss about it all the time in forums and conferences and seminars, in dialogues. And we are talking about not just gender equality, but in this current situation, we're talking about the population of women is increasing, and there are many, many talented women around, which are playing very important role in just what they say smart economics, yeah, what we usually call as smart economics. But having said that, for me to introduce the two distinguished speakers, I think Dato' Nur Aisyah have elaborated very, very well about them just now. They're amazing. I managed to speak to them yesterday evening. Wandee got in yesterday, and Dr. Shaikha, an amazing woman. She's like a really inspiring person to me. I think Wandee will start off with the session. Yeah, and Wandee is into Wandee Khunchornyakong. Yeah. Yeah, she's the chairman and CEO of SPCG, a public listed company in Thailand. And she just told me this morning she have three, she was graduated in law, bachelor's degree in law, and Master's in Business Administration and Political Science, and also she have a PhD in Leadership. But she said, you don't have to call me Dr. Wandee. So this is the humble type of people that you're talking about, yeah? So Dr. Wandee, if you can just share with us for 10 minutes or 15 minutes the most of your experience on how you develop the company, persevere, how you get the company going to be listed from scratch and things like that. I'm sure you have faced a lot of difficulties in bringing up the business. And the second speaker will be the amazing Dr. Shaikha Al-Maskari. She is really amazing. She was working with ADNOC. ADNOC is a national oil company of Abu Dhabi. I'm dealing with ADNOC, actually. And now she's running a company which is called Tricon Energy Operation. Yeah, and also so many business that she's involved in, oil and gas, food, water, you name it, she have it. So when I asked her, why do you do so many things? She said, well, when my client asked me for food and catering, I venture into food and catering. When they ask me for mineral water, I go into water. When they ask me for all sorts of things, I'll make sure I'll deliver to my client what they ask me for. So I think these are the things, the quality of a woman that we should have in all of us, the attitude that we should have all in all of us. Never give up, never say no, just go ahead, follow the flow in whatever people want, whatever the customer requests, the customer is always right. So I think I don't want to talk so much because I know you all are excited to listen to the stories of the two panel speakers, so let's get the ball rolling. I invite Madam Wandee to be the speaker, to start off your...
Thank you very much, Hazimah. And I think since we have men more than less than women in this room, so I let us say good morning to men first, and ladies, and all the ladies. We have to always give our honor to the men, so then they will always supporting us directly and indirectly. So and very important and. To be here, and also thank you very much for Dr. Narasha to invite me to be here this time and to share the story with all of you. I believe that with everyone here in this audience hall, if we put our stories together in a book, I think our book will be the bestseller in the world. And so I think we should try some days. A real life always make it more fruitful to understand and to read. And so it's, I just want to share some of my story that I've been in my life with all of you. I started, and we have a very strict rule on this floor, not to talk about age and how much we weigh. So we will skip these two subjects. And actually, weight lossing is a kind of a life mission. So we always have to keep up with our beauty. I started at my work since 1980. And I designed for my first retirement in 2008. So that's quite some years of work. And I thought that as a woman, we, after hardworking or lifelong being a businesswoman and being a housewife, we need some of our times. I dream to go shopping. I dream to go for spas. So then I enjoy my 1.5 years so much. I can do things that I never do in life before. Going to spas, going to library, going to do something charity works, the one that, you know, I really love to help people. And until 2009, so there is a government announcement about supporting renewable energy in our country. So which is not just a solar business, But wind power and waste and also other kind of renewable energy. But I happen to be and have some small knowledge in solar power. So which is convert sunlight to electricity as the picture you see now. And so we at that time I am a jobless person. Just walking around, and then the announcement has been on the website for like over 6 months. Nobody applied for getting support from the government or getting business done. And then I start doing my study. Why nobody submit any application to do this business? And they all believe that the business model cannot be developed into the commercial scale. So no one's going to make it happen. And it's so difficult, even energy is clean, free energy from the sun, but it's not workable by bankability. So, so it's quite a challenge, and it's starting from my inner power, which is my own passion. If I can make it happen, so then I can create a new page of energy, and we can pass on the new form of energy to our next generation. So then, since I am a jobless person, so then I might put some of my time, you know, to do some model, business model study, things like that. So then, as Dr. Nolasa said, that I've been working on the that when any of the investment, you have to have equity part and a financing part. And so equity, I have to have partners. And this is, I've been working to every bank for the financier to the project. And we have, in Thailand, we have like 5 big banks, and all of them say no to this project because they consider greenfield. And nobody done it before, and it's so difficult to for the bank to give loan to any of the brand new project. So then I walked to the last bank, which is named Kasikorn Bank or K Bank. Their color is green, like this green. Huh? So then I said to them, if you say no to me, you must change the color of your bank. So then, otherwise, I go to the court, you know. So you are green, you are using green color, so you must support the green business. So the last bank works. So they listen, at least they listen. And they set up a team to help study how does it work. And in terms of numbers and also a project financing for the first one. And for the equity, they give me homework. Even you have your own money, bank cannot support the projects because we need to have an institute, some kind of a government fund or international funds, things like that. So then, and actually at that time, I don't have money because I plan to retire. I spend all my money, not for beauty, not for just beauty, and but also building some kind of things that I can settlement in my retirement, which is mainly high-rise building, house, and whatever. So then where I have some more cash left for my shopping, and so then when I need the capital for the first project, which is the around $21 million. So then I try to negotiate bank to support like 75% to 80%, but bank agree to like 60%. So I have to look for 40% myself, which is I cannot remember, $7-8 million, something like that. So then I call my friends, whom very rich, you know, just like Dr. Nolasha or Hazimah. Nobody, not I don't know Dr. Shaikha at that time, otherwise I call her. And and nobody believe in the projects. And my friend said, oh, this is something I never know before. So and I cannot get none of my friends invest in this project. So then I just asked my mother and my husband, whom here also, to sell some one house and one land. one house and one piece of land because I want to do this business. And then I got the government fund, around 1.5 million, and I got IFC to support around $2 million at that time. And so yes, I don't know, because my business most of the time is internally in Bangkok or in Thailand. So when K-Bank said to me, I have to get international partners, I said, who is international partner? So they gave two names, ADB and IFC. So I said ADB, so ADB is ASEAN Development Bank. But okay, let's get IFC since it's more international, you know. So if they say no, so then okay, I will just skip my idea. So then I Google first, where is IFC? And they said, okay, in ASEAN, the head office in Hong Kong. And then I flew to Hong Kong, and they asked me, why are you here for? So I want to ask you to do investment with me to develop the first solar farm project. Actually, it is a power plant, but I don't want to call a power plant because it's kind of like when people in the rural area, when they listen to power plant, they will think of something pollution. They will think of biomass. They will think of coal, fire, things like that. So they have a lot of NGOs that against all this idea. So I changed the definition from solar power plant to solar farms. So they think I grow something. So at least I have time to explain how does it work, that the energy produced from the solar farm is clean, environmental friendly, low carbon society, and this and that. So then in 2010, April 21st, I was successfully starting the first solar farm by debt ratio of 60-40. So 60 by our own equity consists of me, IFC, and the government fund. And K-Bank support 60%. And yeah. So then K-Bank said, oh, Wandee, you can sit down 3 months to 6 months just to see how your son will work for you. So then after the first project run, so I have to sit and wait for 3 to 6 months for monitoring how many kilowatt hour we can produce from each of the solar farms and whether the money can pay back for the debt. And so this and that. So then we were successfully for the first one. So we starting another two in the same 2010. I have a lot of difficulties for the first one, and the second one, third one, until the sixth, we got better debt ratio of 70-30. Instead of 60-40, now 70-30. And now we have 75-25. And the best interest rate equal to other power generation in the country. So like 5% that we pay. So from 7.5 down to 5%. And all the banks that they never believed before, BBL, other bank, all the big names, now supporting the project, not just to us, but to other people. So at that time, we started with the private company in Thailand, we call Company Limited, right? Solar Power Company Limited. So to invest 34 solar farms that we have, I need around $800 million of the total investment. So I have to find the equity part around $200 million. So then I have no money. The best and the possible way, the only way that I can make it happen, so we have to backdoor listing the company that already listed in the stock market. So so I was successfully do the back they don't call backdoor now because it's not polite. So they call reverse takeover the company that listed. Yeah, and 15
done.
That, okay, so then I think that's kind of the story that we now have all the fundraise and we have all the bridging from the bank to support for 34 solar farms and will be complete in next year. And then my next roadmap is solar rooftop and energy efficiency in all kind related. So we are now growing in trends, which is green energy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Marvelous. It's very, very familiar experience. I think all of us face the same thing. You know, women, we get bonded with each other quite easily. I met my good friend, Saha from Egypt, and now listening to her story over dinner and in the bus, while we were in the bus, we can relate to each other and we feel connected quite easily. I can feel you, Wandee, and because I've experienced the same thing, you know, the sisterhood, like what Dr. Nuraisha was saying just now, this morning, is really like we get bonded to each other quite easily. So I can feel you because I'm also facing the same problem during the early days of my business. I think without further ado, I think we wanted to hear the part from Dr. Shaikha. She has so many years of experience, but I'm sorry, you only have 15 minutes, Doctor. Please proceed.
Thank you. That's a real challenge. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. You see that to begin with, I'm wearing our national flag. I made this with it.
Oh, great. Congratulations.
I was almost 18 years when I left without celebrating, so I took the shot. Secondly, we're talking about change. I'm a grandmother, and she gave me 15 minutes to tell about my story. Grandmothers, you know, when you sit with your grandchildren in bed, you tell the story, and you get tired, you start cutting it short. Grandma, you forgot this. And because the children memorize the story, come back. So I'll try to be short. We're talking about change. For me, Shakespeare said, some are born great, some achieve greatness. Some have greatness thrust on them. So some are born to do business, in my own version of Shakespeare. Some achieve business, some have business thrust on them. That is my story. I started my business, I grew up, I never had to sign a check, I was given carte blanche. I went shopping, I did whatever I want to buy for my friends, for everything else. I never even thought somebody has to pay for it because it was a complimentary card from my mother. And then my mother died. And our family company, Al Maskari Holding, was at the time one company trading in oil and then gas. And then I didn't give it any thought. I lost my mother and I had three little children. One was about 1.5 years old, another one 4 years old, another one 7 years old. Then, when in business school, after I finished my doctorate in geophysics, I'd not decided, I didn't know much about business, so they sent us to Cranfield Institute of Technology, which is now Cranfield University, to do an MBA. There, we are taught, always expect the unexpectable. Always have in business, ask, what if not, what if not, what if not? Well, I was trained to believe when analyze anything, what if not? I didn't own ADNOC, the government owned it. Oil flows night and day, even without any effort. So it didn't make much difference to me. But I never thought of one thing. What if I lose those who are really making my life so beautiful? And I did it in a matter of a couple of years. I lost my husband, I lost my brother. I first lost my mother, who is the founder and leader of the company. 2 days, she was a great lady, 2 days after signing a contract to the German company to establish the first refinery in the United Arab Emirates. Then the companies called me after the funeral and all that. What do we do about this? I said, just wait, because I didn't know what to do. Then, the love of my life, leaving me with 3 little children, my husband died. because we have 4 months and 10 days of Idda in isolation, and I was crying night and day. Then I got a phone call from the bank. You need to sign some checks. But I'm not supposed to. I'm in isolation. I'm in Idda. I cannot see man. No mom will send a lady at home. And I stared at it. I said, what am I supposed to do? I said, we can say. HSBC did not have a lady to show me what to do. The company were all men. I'm not supposed to see men. And most of them, I'm not supposed to see local men who are in my board. See, we have everybody marriageable, cousins, everybody else. And men tend to be very self-conscious and self-interested. So here I was, after I inherited the thing, everybody was thinking, she's game. I'm going to propose. No kidding. They just looked at the corporation. And I was so defensive. And during my time, I went through Ramadan, and all I did was pray and pray and pray. What should I do now? This is the legacy of my family. And my family, believe it or not, say that we trace ourselves for 2,000 years, pre-Islamic. But it's my family who wrote the history. So you take it with a grain of salt, this is true or not. However, I was thinking about it and I said, well, I'll take it. And that comes back when we come back for change. It was an overnight change thrust on my life. From a life of luxury, of having fun in Europe and going to school in England and everything, suddenly I have to see how many employees we have and what to do, how to trade in oil. I'm an upstream, I'm a geologist. Suddenly I did nothing, I knew nothing about the downstream, the trading of oil. So I started learning about it throughout Ramadan. Then I thought, I'll go and do it. And at first, nobody took me seriously. They would come to my office and ask my secretary, they have an appointment to see Sheikh Al-Maskari. When they entered the office and they saw me, and they said, I have a meeting with Sheikh Al-Maskari, me. It's not Sheikh. Shaikha, it's a lady. And some of the people just didn't even give me the respect to sit down across the table. They said, you have sons, you have brothers? Why? I own the company. Why don't you sit in and talk to me? And that was the first challenge. So it raises an escalating degree of challenge, to challenge society, to prove that they can do it, and to keep on change and the pursuit of improvement, the pursuit of excellence is a constant, a work in progress, whether it's in nation building or economy or building of yourself is a work in progress. You cannot say, I did it. I am doing it and I have to go on doing it, whether I like it or not. And the goal is not how much business you have or how much business how much money in the bank you have accumulated. The goal is, what is it actually that you want out of life? So it is self-searching. And of course, as we age, the process gets modified because our perception of life changes. What I thought of at a 32-year-old and what I'm thinking of now is very different. Just recently, I just landed in JFK, and the immigration officer looked at me and said, so in and out of the United States all the time. Probably the way I'm dressed got a little bit suspicious. He said, Mom, what do you do? I said, business. What business do you do? I said, everything legal, everything. Everything moral, you tell me, I'll do it. And why moral? Because there are some countries, they legalize what we think is immoral. So I say, sir, maybe some things in this country, or particularly in Amsterdam and all that, is legal. I won't do that. But anything legal, And you tell me, I'll go and do it and try to do it the best I can. So inheriting Tricon Energy Operations was actually called Al Maskari Establishment. So I thought, let's get out the tag. Al Maskari, the family name, call it Tricon. I was my way from Abu Dhabi to Dubai to meet big delegation from overseas. And I want to impress them. So Al Maskari Establishment doesn't look too tribal, too local. I have to have a brand name. So I'm thinking, what? Where are we? We're United States, we're in Europe, we're in Asia. Three continents, Tricon. Wow. By the time I got to Dubai, Mom, I said, I own Tricon Energy Operations. Yeah, that's our new name. We're branding it. I branded it on the way from Abu Dhabi to Dubai. Yeah, 5 minutes. Anyway, from Tricon, we're the main client of ADNOC. ADNOC, I was an employee of ADNOC. I had to resign. They refused my signature because I'm the first UA national, PhD, even graduate, and particularly geophysicist. So I was sort of a showcase. So you cannot resign. I said, I have to because I am your client now. I did. And with that, then ADNOC needs to build buildings, you know, in the oil fields. So they started making the tenders and everything. They said, I can do it. You don't own a construction company. Well, from today I will. Yeah. So I went. I didn't realize, see, I inherited Tricon. When I went to the municipality department of economy and said, I want to establish a construction company, I said, no, you don't. Why? Women allowed to have hairdressing salon, fashion shops, this, but the woman is not allowed. I said, over my dead body. I am going to own this. Show me some place. We have to be careful of those experts who come with fatwa. I said, look, I'm as conservative practicing Muslim as you are, and full respect. I was telling really the chairman of the municipality, who was actually Department of Economy, show me one ayah in the Quran or Hadith saying woman cannot own a construction company. And I said, I'll take it up. If I have to take up to our president, if I have to take up to the United Nations or to the Hague, sir, we better make a deal now. Otherwise, I'll be loud and vocal. That was 1981. Arab Spring had not started yet, so nobody would take you seriously. Okay? Well, after a while, they decided, better the two over the two evil, give her the license. Yeah. So I did. Before you know it, I had special class. When I was competing with the guys in construction. Then decided the food in the fields, because I was also going to the field, was really very bad. And the engineers, we have 13,000 engineers in the field. And so I said, why don't we have a French catering company. I said, I'll create Tricon Food Services. So I went ahead and created Tricon Food Services with catering company. With that, I started trading in bulk foods. Why? Because the military, the supermarkets, everybody. I learned how to trade in wheat, sugar, coffee, tea, ketchup from Malaysia, oil, everything else. Suddenly, I became a big food services businesswoman. Well, a businesses competing with a tall guy in the commodity stock market. Okay. So we went Tricon Energy, Tricon Healthcare, Tricon General Contracting, okay? Then I was given an annual report for ADNOC to do. So I got this British company, they wrote the thing, every time I kept on editing it, because I spoke better English than they did, although they were British. So I decided, what does it do if I take this job? I said, you have to have a media company. What does it take to have a media company? You have to go to the Minister of Information. I went there and met the minister. We are not going to give a media in the hands of a woman. I said, well, it doesn't have to be to forget I'm a woman. Is Tricon owning it? Hey, Tricon Energy? Okay. He didn't even know Tricon Energy is behind it is a woman. He said, so okay, Tricon Global Advertisement and Publicity. And here we come. I decided we cannot be jack of all trade in a very short time. Therefore, instead of reinventing the wheel, I went out the world. In general contracting, I got the best to partner with. I didn't go to the little regional contracting. Media, I went to Singapore. I partnered with the Singapore government, Singapore Expo Venture, the company that made the economy of Singapore. Healthcare, I partnered with National Healthcare Group of Singapore. Always 50, say, your government, I'm corporate, we are all equal under God, 50-50. No. Equal representation, revolving chairmanship. I sit in front of me, a ministers. When we are board, we are board members. And Singapore is a great place. So I grew up with Singapore at National League. Then I realized that there is a security concern. And also, one time I was going in one of the Gulf countries and just having, going through the transfer to another aircraft, I saw the way they were talking to the passengers. These passengers are transiting through our airports. And the police, that way, screaming, I said, over my dead body. These people are transiting in our country. You have to treat them like our guest. So here I go again. I said, look, I'm going to open a company that teaches the police what to do properly. Okay? Really. And I did. So where I went in the Justice Institute of British Columbia. So I opened Global Institute of Justice and Technology. Why technology? Is cybersecurity, national security, aviation. Would you believe it? We train sky marshals. The guy sitting with you in business class trying to read a newspaper is actually armed. We train them. So we ended up having a security company. World leader, 42 governments in the world, even Europe, okay? Then we had, with Singapore and then Portugal, I wanted to know about technology and innovations. So I partnered with the Portuguese government, Madeira Tecnopolo.
Doctor.
Okay? So we had 50-50 again, a city before Internet City. It's science and technical. The beauty is it, I just have one thing. When we are doing business, I have three principles. Number one, ethics don't have a price tag.
Yeah.
In all the Middle East, in all the Muslim world, and now we realize those who are telling about ethics, the European, they were looking down on us. They have exposed themselves as being doing worse than we were doing, but just it was sophisticated in it. And therefore, we have ethics don't have price tag. If you are great in your country and you are being ordered, don't come to our country and get some guy with high political clout to make a deal just because you are going to get tender, guaranteed. So for us, we don't. Ethics, we stand and die by ethics. And number two, consider the humanity of your partners. Who are our partners? Our clients, our actual partners, our customers, our counterparts, people who are with you, community, everybody is a human. One more thing. And the third thing, you know, in the world, I sit, whether it's in China or United States, everything, said, look, you have always to be honest to your partners, with your customers or your partner, your actual clients or your partners or your country. And with that, we have to be honest with mutual respect, mutual trust, and transparency. And therefore, I set out, actually, when I sit, they look at me like I'm a preacher. No, I live at it. I live it, and you know, I will walk out of tender, I will walk out of deal once I think that it stinks. Somebody is guaranteeing me the tender.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much. Wow, amazing. Why I have to stop you both 15 minutes, because we need to interact with the audience, because for them to ask you more questions so that you can answer them. And another big round of applause to both speakers, please. Amazing. I think, you know, the difference between starting your own business from scratch one day and inheriting a business from your family is a tall order, especially when you're born on a silver platter and you have to go down to the floor and really do it, isn't it? So, I mean, both is very challenging, both. Starting a business and running a business started by your family is really a tall order. But anyway, I want to start the ball rolling by asking the audience for question and answer, and we quickly answer them, whatever that they need to know. But if I may ask, Wandee, Dr. Wandee, what makes I know you've been telling us about you into solar energy and things like that, but how do you face the challenges? How do you like what I'm facing? People keep on saying that a woman shouldn't be studying so high up because at the end of it, you'll be in the kitchen handling your husband or handling your family or things like that. We keep on being bugged by this kind of question. So how do you answer them? How do you overcome all these challenges and the banks turning us off to say that, you know, we have never heard of you and your business have no experience. So how do you overcome all these challenges, Wandee?
I think first, we have to have faith in ourselves, and you have to build up the belief in your heart and your soul that you can do it. So with your then you can empower the others, and so passion and success is all built by you. So then I create my own faith. I believe in myself that I can do it. So then how to do it? So then that's very, very important. So just like Dr. Shaikha mentioned, so we have to have honor, we have to have faith in our partners, we have to show everything transparency. We have to have people believe in the same thing you believe. Then you can make things happen.
Thank you. Doctor, what are the unique capacities and qualities of women entrepreneurs that would help them to stay ahead of competition? You know, you in that business, there's so many other people doing the same business. So what is the unique capacities or qualities that the woman should have in them? Okay. The capacities of a woman, the qualities of a woman that to remain there, to sustain their business, to be in the business that they are in, yeah, with all the challenges and competition.
I had once at university a visitor, a lady. She wrote a notoriously clandestine book. I won't say his name. Okay, when I was going to school about 40 years ago. But the first sentence she said, the thesis of her business, which was not a very reputable business, she said, take stock of the market. Study the market. Study your competition. Take stock of yourself, your own asset. Go for it with what all that you've got. So in competition, how do you face the competition? There is legitimate competition, and I thrive in it. And if I lose a tender, I am the first one to take my telephone and call the chairman of the winning company and say, congratulations, you did great. Can we cooperate at any level? I said, here she goes again. I said, look, you may have some area, we have more expertise than you. I want you to succeed so you can win over me the next tender. They said, forget it, Shaikha, you are a loser, okay? But in our world, there is actually unhealthy competition. When I go to a tender and somebody tells me, I know I'm going to win. The tenders in the Middle East, the tenders in Africa, in most in Asia, are preordained. So I ask myself, why on earth do they have international tenders? Why do we waste our time, put bid bond, all that? I cannot, I am literally inside. But do I implode inside because I see injustice? I go after the injustice. Sometimes I really make a fool of myself. One time in an Arab country, I won't say where I am because they will cancel my visa to go there. Okay, I knew my company were the best of the tenderers, and I knew technically we are the best. I made sure commercially we are the best. Then, and the project management Turner International called me and said, Doctor, you got it. It was about $2.8 billion tender, and I knew it is mine. Whoa. Okay, now, then the same project manager called me to apologize, an American guy. He says, Doctor, I'm sorry. He's going to another company. So why? Oh, from the authorities up above. I said, up above authority is God. I don't recognize anybody else. Okay? He said, please, I am on your side. I said, from today, you are my enemy. and I'm going to show you.
Okay.
So, because as an American company, this is a really good story. As an American company, my company that was tendering is an American company. I went straight to the American embassy. I said, it's unfair. I went to the commercial attaché. I said, you know, you are there on that chair on taxpayers' money. I'm one of the taxpayers. Do your work. I am being unjustly treated. This is the tender. I know I'm the winner. Say, Shaikha, you write the letter to the committee. I will put it on my letterhead. I will promise you I'll send it. And she did. It was a woman. And really, she did it. Then after that, I thought I will go with a very strong letter to the chairman of the tender board. And I wrote, this is really, you have to look at our profile, look at our, this is why I should win. This is unfair, and you should investigate corruption. Okay? After that, quiet. Then I got a member of my family. She said, no, you know what? You really did it. I said, why? Before you go on and become Joan of Arc, you do a little bit of homework, Shaikha. I said, what did I do now? The guy you sent a letter to investigate the corruption is the chairman of the tender board committee. I said, I know. That's why I went to him. Well, the tender is won by his company.
Okay.
And he has to be a member of the royal family, so you are dead meat. I said, oh my God, what do I do now? I said, just keep quiet. So some, you can go competition, but it is unjust competition. Before I know it, I know I have to look at, can I fight this and survive? Remember yesterday, we had the dancer, and the day before yesterday, and they said the warrior was looking at uncertain hurdles ahead. And I was thinking, life has uncertain hurdles. Therefore, when I go, I first do my homework, investigate with all whom right. I am now competing. If okay. I know it's preordained, I say, you are invited to tender? No, thank you. I just want tender because I don't want my blood pressure go
Doctor,
up.
Amazing. I mean, those are the qualities that an entrepreneur should have, actually. High ethics, high integrity, know your product well, know your staff well, and all those things. We'll summarize it afterwards. Can we open to the floor? Any question for the both speakers? Salha, please. Microphone. Right in front, please. Right in front, the first row. Thank you. Can you just mention your name and where you're from?
Morning, I'm Sahar Saleh from Egypt. I was wondering, how many women are you having in your own companies? Whether you're advocating your stories to others in your own company. I'm not talking about CSRs. I don't want to talk about NGOs and other activities. But the real percent of women working in both companies, Ms. Wanda and Dr. Shaikha. Thank you.
In my organization, we have women like 80%. So because I believe that women's trends more in better in details, better in numbers, and in terms of like ethic and honorable, I think women is more easy to see that way. So we use a lot of labor at the construction. So those are for men's work. Sorry, men. Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
I didn't get the question.
Salah is asking about, maybe you can repeat your question? How many women are working in your company?
That's confidential.
Because
before you know it, our governments will look at me and thinking I'm starting another Arab Spring. We are present in almost every continent, in almost every country, in almost most of the capitals in the world. And one major superpower one time over lunch told me, Shaikha, you have more presence in the world than we have. I said, sir, Your Excellency was the ambassador. Your government superpower is in the habit of making enemies. Myself, I go out to make friends. That's why I have more presence than you. So when we are out there, number one, whether it is mining, we're in mining. The first thing I look at is people. I love people. I love life. I know the clock is ticking. And I ask whether we are doing business or we're sitting with the family. Where it is an experience of life that we have to savor. And therefore, if I take a concession, the number one thing I'm thinking, what can I do for these people? They are there. This is, yes, I got concession to mine gold, but it's their land. Therefore, I look at the women and look at what can they do. I have my mine, the workers in the mine with the 1,000, the 10,000, they need food. Therefore, I start them up with a catering kitchen, catering company. I start them up to provide services as subcontractors for startups to my company, whether it is oil and gas, whether it is, of course, there is more propensity as a woman to work with women, but also as a woman, is the propensity, it's there, the compassion, the milk of human kindness to be a mother. So in India, everybody mama. In China, believe me, I don't speak the language, mama, and they speak to me in Chinese, mama. So particularly age has an advantage. And therefore, with that, I get many of the youngsters, not because we are the best employers, but because they know I nurture their aspirations. So we have really thousands and thousands of women working for us.
Excellent.
But not directly as employees. I started them up as entrepreneurs. Just one example, what you can do. I'll take half a minute. A friend of mine in 2006 insisted, please, Shaikha, he's a politician and a professor. Come to my constituency, come, because the election was coming. I was so sick and tired of it. I said, okay, get an aircraft, I'll come. Over lunch. So we get aircraft. I didn't realize the 3.5 hours flight. That we went Ankara, we had to go. I didn't even know where we were going. We went there, it was Sunday night. Monday morning, 11 o'clock, he took me to show me his constituency, the city. Everywhere there were these youngsters sitting, drinking tea on these rattan stools. I asked him, his name Aziz. I said, Aziz, is it a public holiday today? He said, why do you think? Everybody's sitting 11 o'clock, they're drinking tea. He said, because that's why I brought you here. We have absolutely total unemployment. He said, can you help us? What can I do? He said, we are growing wheat. If you will put up a factory, we can employ people. I said, how many? 500, if a big factory, 1,000. I said, look, in 2-3 streets, you have more than 1,000 kids. It won't make a difference.
We can allow
so this. I ended up, I never heard of microfinance. I ended up, I just saw on television, Mohsin Yunus from Bangladesh, the guy who started my Grameen Bank. I called Aziz, the politician, said, if I call, I think this stupid Arab woman is calling me, maybe Muhammad Yunus, professor, will not pay attention. You as a politician from Turkey, call him. To make the story short, said, I didn't open the pasta factory because one thing, I don't like pasta anyway. And the second thing, I didn't think we can employ a lot of people. But we started, I said, Muhammad Yunus, I don't want your interest, this, I will donate the money. We start the microcredit system here to give people to show them how to fish, not to give them ready-made help. And on the 13th of June 2006, we opened in Turkey, Diyarbakir, what we called the Poor Man's Bank. I 100% funded it as a sadaqah, not to be, as I don't want my name in the board, I don't want anything, just to open it. I am glad to say that today we are employing, we have 40,000 successful entrepreneurs.
Wow.
Okay. Employing over 400,000 people in 6 years. And we have been selected last year, not 2 years ago, as the best microcredit project in Europe.
Excellent.
It was a coincidence.
Thank you. Alhamdulillah, thank you. It's a great challenge, actually, to be moderating two inspiring women. They have lots of things to share. Doctor, next time, give them more time. Give us 2 hours. Okay, we only have 1 hour, and I was warned by the organizer, keep to the timing, keep to the timing. But anyway, we can take another 2 more questions, please, ladies.
Yes,
grab this opportunity.
Why are we waiting for the question?
There's one lady there. Can you pass the mic to the...
One more question. I am Dr. Asfour. I am president for the Egyptian Businesswomen Association. I really congratulate the two speakers. Fantastic. Because what they really achieved is came from themselves, from their power. And that's really what we are promoting. How can we as women be powerful and wait for don't wait for others to give us power? And I always believe that power is actually the potency, the capacity to act and to implement. You had an idea in your head and you worked for it, you planned for it and you implemented it. And that's actually what we have. We have to have the real will from ourselves.
What's the question, please?
The question now is that about, because you said there is no ayah in Quran which really forbid us from doing anything. Now is the what's happening now in the Arab uprising. We have to have a one voice because Quran never forbid us to be an entrepreneur. Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha was an entrepreneur. Never forbid us to be educated because Sayyida Nafisat al-Ilm, she was educated. And the first version of Quran is Iqra, seek knowledge. Now what's happening by the name of religion is to get the women behind, not educated, marry at 9 years old. What can we here in this hall with the World Islamic Economic Forum do and not to use the Islam to forbid women from empowering themselves?
Thank you. Thank you very much. That's just, I don't like to see Mazrin waving at me saying that time's up. Anyway, ladies, Dr. Wandee is supposed to leave before lunch, but I asked her to stay on. I said, during the lunchtime, some of the ladies during this session, they will be very shy to ask questions from the floor. So lunchtime, ladies, use this valuable time to approach these two wonderful ladies, inspiring ladies, to ask questions, as many questions as you want during the lunch break. But just to summarize a bit of what Dr. Shaikha and Dr. Wandee have shared with us today, the key word of a successful woman entrepreneur is that we must hold our ethics right. We must persevere with all the difficulties that we face. A lot of hardship, a lot of determination. Never, ever give up. And practice integrity. Yeah? So you don't condone to corruption. Yeah. So you get your business based on your own merits. You don't have to offer anything. You don't have to even offer to wear miniskirts or to take off your hijab just to get the business, yeah? So just remain who you are. You will face a lot of negative and a lot of things, the challenges that people were bound to tell us or to bring us down. I just would like to share with you one quote here that I find it very interesting. An arrow can only be shot by pulling it backwards. When life is dragging you back with difficulties, just imagine that it's going to launch you into something great. So with that, thank you very much to the two ladies and thank you for your audience. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And thank you once again, a big hand to our moderator, Dato Hazimah, as well as two speakers, Madam Wandee, as well as Dr. Shaikha. And we'd like to invite the speakers and the moderator, firstly, to have a group photograph taken on the stage.